In this video, we're going to talk about the three types of endurance training sessions where you can use lactate to regulate, to measure, to quantify the type of effort you're doing, to see if you're at the right intensity for the type of session you're trying to do, and also to quantify, to measure your progress over time. So first of all, it's important to understand what lactate is and especially what it's not. Lactate is not the cause of fatigue, right? Neither is lactic acid. Typically, lactic acid doesn't really exist inside the body, or if it does, it's in very, very small proportions compared to lactate. It's essentially, it's almost the same molecule. It's not the same, but it's almost the same molecule. But we mostly have lactate circulating in our body, in our blood, in our muscles, and not lactic acid. Lactate is not the cause of fatigue, but you have to understand that it's what we understood it to be for a long time, because we couldn't measure much inside the blood, inside the body, and we didn't know what caused fatigue. And when we saw that, hey, when you hunt animals down and then you kill them and then you sample their blood and then you measure their lactate, the lactate's elevated, they were running, they were fatigued. Lactate, fatigue, makes sense, right? But it's actually other molecules that cause muscle fatigue and cause central fatigue as well, namely inorganic phosphate and hydrogen ions, which are produced in parallel to lactate. So you could say that lactate is a good proxy for fatigue, meaning that when there's high levels of lactate in the blood, we are going to have more fatigue present, but not because of lactate, because of the other metabolites that come along with lactate inside the body during a physical effort. So now that we know this, we can also understand that lactate is a source of fuel. It's a half sugar, right? If you take a molecule of glucose and you cut it in half, you almost perfectly have a molecule of lactate. And lactate can be utilized inside the body. Your mitochondria uses lactate as a source of fuel. It can switch it to pyruvate, all those fun things. But the important thing to understand is that lactate is a source of fuel for your body, for your muscles, for your brain, for your heart. All those parts of your body use lactate. You can even transform lactate back into glucose, into sugar, via the liver. So it's not lost. And like I said, it's something that you can measure inside the blood. Typically, you would prick the finger if you're by yourself. I prick the ear when I do it with somebody else. It's just easier to access. But you essentially measure the concentration of lactate inside the blood, which is expressed in millimoles per liter. And this gives you information as to what level of intensity you're currently holding, okay? And what I mean by this is that there are four levels of intensity inside the body when you talk about endurance exercise. And we're not talking about zones, we're talking about levels of intensity. And if you want the right terminology, we would say intensity domains. If you look in the exercise physiology literature, you will read about the moderate domain, which is low intensity, the heavy domain, which is medium intensity, the severe domain, which is high intensity, and the extreme domain, which is very high intensity. And to kind of benchmark those on something that you probably know about, if we talk about thresholds, low intensity or the moderate domain is below the first threshold. The heavy domain or medium intensity is between the first and the second threshold. High intensity or the severe domain is above the second threshold. And then the extreme domain typically lies in intensities that you can hold for less than 2 minutes. And if we want to get technical for a second, the distinction between severe and extreme, in the severe domain, if you push it long enough, you will reach your VO2 max or your VO2 peak. And then in the extreme domain, the effort is so intense that you'll typically reach muscle failure before you reach your VO2 peak or your VO2 max. So now that we've understood those four levels of intensity or those four intensity domains, we can think about which domain can I actually quantify in training. I'm not talking about testing, I'm just talking about training with lactate. And in my opinion, there's three main domains of intensity or levels of intensity that are interesting to quantify with lactate during your training sessions, whether you're cycling, whether you're running. And I'll start with the first one. I'll give you some examples and we'll run through the other ones after. So the first level of intensity that you might want to quantify or regulate with lactate is low intensity. Low intensity session Typically, physiologically speaking, we're below the first threshold. And this means that, yes, your blood is pumping, your heart is pumping, everything's working, but your muscle, metabolically speaking, your muscles, the working muscles, typically the legs on the bike on the run, will be able to manage the internal load by themselves. And what that means for blood lactate is that those measures or those measurements of blood lactate are going to stay very low and stable over time in that low intensity. And so, for example, if I prick my finger right now, I might be at maybe 1 millimole of lactate at rest. I'm walking, but it's going to be zone one, top of zone one, maybe zone two. And so 1 millimole of lactate at rest. Now I start exercising, but I stay below the first threshold. I stay at low intensity. Well, for some people, it might go up a bit. Typically in running, you'll see it go up more. So it might go up to 1.2, 1.3. But then if I measure it again in 10, 20, 30 minutes, it will stay in that area. Maybe even go down a little bit as my aerobic system warms up and my mitochondria start recycling all that lactate. Or all that lactate. There's not a lot that's produced because I'm primarily using slow twitch fibers, which typically consume lactate during effort rather than produce it. Fast twitch fibers produce lactate. Slow twitch fibers recycle lactate during exercise. It's a simplification. If you have questions on this, leave me a comment below. So low intensity, we'll see low levels of lactate and we'll see them being stable over time. So again, it might go up a bit from resting values. It might go down a bit if you're well trained, and that should stay constant over time. So you can prick your finger after 5 or 10 minutes, prick your finger again after half an hour, after 40 minutes, after 50 minutes, and see how it's evolving. If it's staying low and stable, you're good. You're still at low intensity. If it starts creeping up, you might be going a little too hard for that low intensity, easy session, right? And it's also something you can use to see how durable you are, to see how resistant to fatigue you are, right? And for this, I would start looking at longer time spans. Can I keep stable levels of lactate? And heart rate works well for that as well. Can I keep stable levels of lactate after 30 minutes, after an hour, after an hour and a half, after 2 hours, etc., etc.? And when you start to see those values going up for a constant power or speed, you know that you're starting to fatigue and you should slow down if you want to keep doing that session at low intensity. And you can see when that inflection point happens in time, over time. I wouldn't test that every day, but it's something you can kind of have a key monitoring session with lactate every so often and see how it evolves over time as you're trying to build that durability or that resistance to fatigue. Now, the second type of training where I would use lactate is the medium intensity. And if we're talking about zones, we were talking about zone 3, zone 4. Zone 3, tempo above the first threshold. Zone 4, threshold below the second threshold. Okay. And typically for those intensities, we will see elevated but stable levels of lactate in the blood. And though the number will vary depending on the level of the athlete, what I mean, and their muscle makeup as well, muscle typology. What I mean by this is if you have more fast twitch fibers, remember they produce more lactate. And so you'll typically see higher levels of lactate for those individuals. Whereas for very endurance profiles, a lot of slow twitch fibers that recycle lactate and that are highly trained, and especially if they're highly trained, then we will see lower levels of lactate. To give you an example, if I'm doing a zone 3 session, a tempo session, maybe 3 times 15 minutes on the bike, I have more powerful profile, more fast twitch fibers from my background in sports. I might be at 2.5, 3 millimoles in zone 3 above my first lactate threshold. Whereas somebody that's more endurance, that has better endurance training capacity than I do, you might see them at 1.5, 2 millimoles for the same intensity relative to their threshold, okay? Because we have to normalize those to the anchor points that we can actually work with, which are the lactate thresholds, first threshold, second threshold. And for a zone 4 session, so maybe 3 times 8 minutes at an RPE of 6, maybe 7. For me, I might have, you know, 5, 5.5 millimoles constant from interval to interval, pretty stable, with no increase or very low increase in RPE. We definitely don't want the RPE going 6, 7, 8, 9 over 4 intervals. Otherwise, you're not doing threshold anymore. You're doing high intensity. So we want it to be stable. We want the lactate to be stable as well. The heart rate is going to creep up. That's normal for anything above the first threshold. We just have to work with that. But somebody who's more endurant than me and has more slow twitch fibers, you might see, you know, 3, 3.5 millimoles for a threshold session. So it really depends on your level of training. It also varies depending on if you're running, if you're cycling, right? So you always have to contextualize those measurements. So that would be the second type of session I would monitor with lactate. And you can periodically repeat the exact same session, 3x8 threshold, for example, or 3x15 tempo. Do the exact same session, exact same output, whether it's speed or power, and then measure your lactate, measure your heart rate, measure your RPE. And if from, you know, one session to the next, and I wouldn't do it, you know, 2 days in a row, or at least not for the purpose of monitoring your progress, but if you do that session, you know, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks apart, exact same session, and you measure those things, well, maybe you'll see 0.5 to 1 millimole drop in lactate if you've been training those intensities consistently in that period of time to a level that allows you to progress, okay? You might see your heart rate go down a few beats, and you might see your RPE go down a little bit as well on the session. And that would be a good sign of progress, and you don't need to test. You could just do the session, measure those parameters, and see the progress, okay? And that will likely mean that your thresholds have moved up and that you've gained in endurance capacity at that intensity specifically. And the third type of session where you can use those lactate measurements would be sprint interval training, very high intensity. So for example, on a Wingate interval, standardize the warm-up and standardize your session, obviously, but over a 30-second period, for example, you could do an all-out sprint. It could be 20 seconds as well, but again, keep it standard from one test to the next, or from one session to the next. Measure your lactate at the end of the interval, measure your lactate maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes after the interval, and you can, this might give you some indication as to your level of fatigue on the day. What I mean by this is, and it's counterintuitive, when you're tired, you will produce less lactate. So after a 20-second sprint, on a day where you're, from a neuromuscular standpoint, where you're more tired, you should see lower levels of lactate. Why? Because when your body is tired, when your central nervous system is tired, you cannot recruit as much muscle mass. And this is why you will typically see lower levels of lactate when you're tired. That's actually one of the strategies that Nils van der Poel, double gold medalist in speed skating at the Beijing Olympics, pardon me. That's a strategy that he used. And if he saw during his threshold season, I encourage you to go and read his ebook, free ebook on how to perform in speed skating. If he saw lower heart rate than usual and lower lactate than usual on his standardized sessions, he would take 2 days off, he would stop the session, take 2 days off, and then restart his training microcycle, because he knew he was tired. And if you're tired, you can't actually absorb the training as well as when you're rested. So those would be the three sessions that you can, or the three types of sessions where you can use lactate to monitor your progress. And if you're interested in learning how to use lactate, whether it's to test yourself, maybe to test some of the athletes that you work with and understand how all this works, I built a specific course on the matter. It's called Protocol 41, and you can find the link down in the description. If you have any questions, leave a comment below. Thanks for watching this video. I'll see you in the next one. Take care.